So good evening, everybody. We are live now. Welcome to Ortho TV, and I hand it over to Shankar sir for further proceedings.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome for today's Ortho Excellence Series talk by Dr. Manoj Pahukar from Nagpur. He'll be talking about current concepts in the management of vascular injuries in orthopedic practice. We have a power-packed faculty to take the discussion in the right direction. We have Dr. Gurpal Singh from Singapore, Dr. Hari Venkatramani from Coimbatore Ganga Hospital, Dr. Ajinkya Ukrande from Sholapur, Dr. Latif Leo from Mangalore, and Dr. Soumyadeep Datta from Kolkata. To introduce today's speaker, Dr. Manoj Pahukar, he has done MS Arth, DNB Arth, and he was a CICOT fellow. He has done fellowships in Belgium. Then he has done AO fellowship, and he is at present working for the last 15 years as senior consultant in orthopedics at Wockhardt Hospital in Nagpur. He has special interest in hip and knee replacement, complex intra-articular fractures, minimal invasive plate osteosynthesis, polytrauma, vascular injuries, geriatric and pelvic acetabular fractures. He has, to his credit, having measured the shortest lady in the world. He has done fellowship under René Vaudant as a deputy fellow in Ghent University Hospital in Belgium. And he has also done the Elizero fellowship in one of the most sought after institution in the world for Elizero surgeries, that is Rizzoli Orthopedic Institute at Bologna in Italy. He has also done AO fellowship from Hong Kong. He has worked as the secretary of Vidarbha Orthopedic Association. He has also worked as the organizing secretary for Maharashtra Orthopedic Association Conference and Vidarbha Orthopedic Association Conferences. He has conducted AO courses. He is an AO fellow. He is a faculty member of the AO, and he has done presentations also on the AO courses at various meetings. He has worked as a faculty at many national state level conferences. Welcome, Dr. Manoj Pahukar.
Thank you, sir.
This is the shortest lady in the world at present. This is Jyoti Amge. You can see that was the picture in 2014, and Dr. Manoj Pahukar was involved in measuring the height when the Guinness World Record people had come to Nagpur to measure the height of this lady. We have an international faculty in the form of Dr. Gurpal Singh. He works at Center for Orthopedic Oncology and Reconstructive Surgery in Singapore. He has done his MBBS from Singapore, then MRCS Edinburgh, then he has done MS in ortho, then FRCS in ortho, and FAMS in ortho. He is very well known for orthopedic oncology, joint replacement, and robotic assisted surgeries. Till recently, he has been working in National University Hospital in Singapore, but recently he has switched over to private practice. Welcome, Dr. Gurpal Singh, for today's meet. We have another senior microvascular surgeon in the form of Dr. Hari Venkatramani from Ganga Hospital, Coimbatore, where he is working for the last 21 years. He is working as a senior consultant at present in the Department of Plastic Surgery, Hand and Reconstructive Surgery. He has special interest in major trauma, reconstruction, brachial plexus injuries, microvascular surgeries for cancer reconstruction and lymphedema. He is Associate Editor of Indian Journal of Plastic Surgery, Secretary of Indian Society for Reconstructive Microsurgery and Brachial Plexus Surgery Group of India. He has many publications, 72 in peer-reviewed journals, articles, and 12 book chapters he has written. He has delivered over 150 international and national papers lectures at various courses, and he has also worked as a live operative faculty for operative workshops across India and even abroad. He has traveled extensively as a brand ambassador for reconstructive microsurgery and as a visiting professor to Bangladesh, Japan, Sri Lanka, Switzerland, New Zealand, USA, and UK. Welcome, Dr. Hari Venkatramani. We also have Dr. Soumidev Datta. He's an orthopedic surgeon from Calcutta. He's at present working as consultant orthopedic surgeon at Apex General Hospital. He's the ex-associate professor of West Bengal Medical Education Service and ex-assistant professor of R.G. Kerr Medical College, Calcutta. We have another young orthopedic surgeon who has shifted to plastic surgery in the form of Dr. Latif Leo from Mangalore. He has done his MBBS, MS Orth and DRB Orth. Subsequently, he has done fellow in National Board of Exams in the subject hand and microvascular surgeries. He is at present working as the unit chief of hand, microvascular and reconstructive surgery at Father Muller Medical College and Hospital in Mangalore. Welcome, Dr. Latif.
Thank you, sir.
We have, amongst all these orthopedic surgeons who are also working as plastic surgeons or reconstructive surgeons, we have a general surgeon working as a plastic surgeon amongst us. That is Dr. Ajinkya Ukrande from Sholapur. He has done his MBBS from Pune, MS from IPGMER from Kolkata, then MCH plastic surgery from Grand Medical College, Mumbai. He has worked at Sir JJ Hospital, Sir St. George Hospital in Bombay, then GT Hospital in Mumbai. His special interest is in trauma and brachial plexus and microvascular injuries. Welcome, Dr. Ajinkya. Friends, before I forget, day after tomorrow, we have one person, one talk series. We have Dr. Vasudev Gadegone from Chandrapur. He'll be talking on intramedullary nailing in forearm fractures in adolescents and adults. Welcome Dr. Manoj Paukar, Dr. Gurpal Singh, Dr. Hari Venkatramani, Dr. Ajinkya, Dr. Latif, Dr. Soumidev for today's Ortho Excellence Series talk by Dr. Manoj Paukar on current concepts in management of vascular injuries in orthopedic practice. Over to you, Dr. Manoj.
So very good evening to all of you. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Shivashankar sir for giving me this opportunity to present my work through his Orthopedic Excellence Series. I also like to welcome all the panelists on board here, Dr. Gurpal Singh from Singapore, Dr. Hari Venkatramani from Ganga Hospital, Coimbatore, Dr. Latish Leo from Mangalore, Dr. Ukunde from Solapur, and Dr. Datta from Calcutta. I also like to thank Dr. Ashok Shang and Bijlani for their continuous efforts and success in these technical presentations. I would acknowledge various stalwarts from Vidarbha, Dr. Shushrut Babulkar sir, Dr. R.M. Chandak sir, Dr. Gadegone sir, all who has helped and contributed in my this experience. So the topic which I am going to discuss today is about the current concepts in the management of vascular injuries in orthopedic practice. This topic has not been covered much in the recent webinars which has been conducted since almost the lockdowns. So this will be a very interesting discussion which we'll be having. So we'll start with this thing, like what orthopedic surgeon is afraid of. Is he afraid of a massive hemorrhage because of vascular injury or any C1, C2 kind of fractures or any pelvic fracture with hemodynamic instability? I think he's not afraid of, but there is certain thing which will come at the end that orthopedic surgeon will be afraid of. So orthopedic surgeons are having some kind of risk because their bone is in the anatomical vicinity of the neurovascular structures, which are bound to injure in cases of trauma. Moreover, near the joints where tethering of vessels or sometimes superficial location makes them more vulnerable to the injuries. These injuries are very troublesome, and if they're not treated properly, they will have their own consequences and risk with serious functional limitations. So all of this my series talk will be divided into these categories. Initially, we'll try to see how will you identify a vascular injury, then how will you evaluate those risk vascular injuries, and then there will be further principles as to how we'll manage these vascular injuries. Leg compartment syndrome, which is common part of all this, we'll try to focus on few fasciotomy techniques, and then independent case scenarios of various cases of different injuries to guide you how to follow protocol for this management. And then very this interesting as to the vascular injuries following elective surgeries. I will be mainly excluding any pelvic injury or pediatric or the vascular procedure which are properly done by the plastic surgeons. What I am going to present is an orthopedician perspective for treatment of these vascular injuries. So we'll start with this case scenario of a young male who has presented in our casualty around 1.5 hours after a road traffic accident. You can see he was having this ipsilateral injury with these fractures. All are close injuries. He is maintaining vitals. There are no other injuries. And his distal pulsations, dorsalis pedis and posterior tibial was absent. It was limb is still good, viable with good movement, good sensation. So if you can see, there are four fractures, mainly the shaft femur, tibial condyle, along with undisplaced femoral condyle and patella fracture. So this being a multi-segment kind of injury, we are as confused as to where is the actual vascular injury. So this is one scenario, and the another scenario of a 56-year-old female who come to her casualty within 1 hour of trauma. And as you can see, she was having a gross crushed injury on her whole of the right lower limb, right from the groin to the deep lobing injury in the right thigh and leg. And she was certainly in hypotensive shock, tachycardia. And also she was not having pulsation distally in the right lower limb. Luckily, there were no associated injuries in the chest or head. Only she was having a tibial fracture on the opposite side. On further evaluation, you can see there was a femur fracture on the same side. His pelvic was luckily stable, no injuries. Only on the opposite side, there is tibia fracture. And as you can obviously see itself in the casualty, the obvious site of injury being the femoral artery. So both of these are vascular injuries. They are present quite early in our casualty. Are these both scenarios same? So do we have the same protocols for management of these injuries? So what ahead you need to go for treatment in these conditions? Which investigation you would advise? Which surgery first, whether you go for internal or external fixation? And how do you further evaluate these injuries? So as you know, once the vascular injury is there, your clock starts ticking because of further ongoing blood loss, progressive ischemia, compartment syndromes, tissue necrosis bound to happen. And as you all know, the irreversible damage will start appearing after 6 hours of vascular injury unless and until you revascularize it. But certainly, in few series, it has now been documented that even the cases who are presenting late, if they have developed a good collateral circulation, there is no major neurological injury, patient are maintaining vitals, you feel their muscles are viable. So this certainly showed that even delayed vascularization up to a particular time limit, in properly selected cases, you could get still acceptable results. Though we think that it's very uncommon, only 3% risk, still it is a very high, and that is more specific in particular injury patterns like a knee dislocation unless and until proved otherwise. It's almost having 16 to 40% of incidence. Then with gunshot injuries, again, it is very high. So a surgeon must understand the kind of mechanism of injury to understand the potential vascular insult, the kind of fracture personality, the presence of dislocation, and the kind of trauma. So the kind of trauma mechanism injury could be a blunt trauma or penetrating, giving more vascular injuries. The blunt trauma could be low energy or high energy. Penetrating could be a gunshot or the stab wounds. And it is very essential to know that blunt trauma has got the higher rate of amputation as compared to the penetrating trauma. This is because blunt trauma presents with very subtle clinical findings. The recognition is delayed, and the blunt trauma usually causes some stretching and shearing of vessel, causing damage and then thrombus formation. They have got very high amputation rate, and the surgeon need to be cautious. Similarly, for penetrating injury, sometimes the injury may be very obvious, but sometimes it could be delayed. Injuries because of the laceration or direct transection of the vessel, and delayed presentation could then further present with pseudoaneurysms or the AV malformations. Mainly, we will be focusing on the trauma part, which is the injury on the vessel, but certainly from orthopedician point of view, compression from outside, which is very also essential to be ruled out, that a simple tight bandage, a cast or tourniquet or compartment syndrome should ideally be first ruled out before you proceed for the vascular injury. So these are the various pathologies. pathologies which could be there, so which a vascular injury can happen right from the simple spasm to the subintimal hematoma to a laceration to a complete transection to a delayed presentation with AV fistula. Most common among these with the laceration and transection and thrombosis and occlusion. And you need to identify this with each individual vascular injury, what kind of vascular trauma it is. You mean sometimes need a treatment, sometimes you do not, especially as a spasm or transient. Again, this kind of high risk injuries, if you see such a massive crush injury, you should suspect for the vascular injury. Floating limb injuries or the diaphyseal segmental fractures, which are very usually high velocity, or open fracture, they have got more propensity for having the vascular injuries. So these are the various arteries along with their regions which could be injured. The most common bone which could cause the vascular injury is the femur, then second is the tibia, third is the humerus, and it is more near the joints like the popliteal in the knee and brachial arteries injured into the elbow. So dislocation, I already told, the knee dislocation, scapulothoracic dislocations may have very high incidence. Elbow dislocation again having around 0.4 to 0.5% of vascular injuries. So if you don't treat them, this further patient will go into the blood loss shock, causing further ischemia, tissue necrosis, gangrene, may lead to amputation. Patient may have systemic symptoms because of the DIC or the ARDS, which is happening because of the septicemia and infection in the wound. Patient could land into multisystem organ failure and ultimately could lead to a mortality. Again, these injuries have got major morbidities because this patient usually needs some kind of initial one major procedure and sometimes then repeated procedures. They frequently need blood transfusions. Also, systemic side effects are sometimes usually happen in almost up to 20% of the patient, mainly the renal kind of problems. And somehow if the limb survives, the further problems of infections because of decreased blood flow, then malunions, non-unions, then further contractions because of the Volkmann shape, contracture, limb length discrepancy, deformities. These are further things which could happen to these patients. Associated nerve injuries also are very common being associated with the vascular injuries. So in clinical features, this patient could be completely asymptomatic to in the patient with having a severe hypotension and shock. You should certainly look for the blood everywhere as to the which other associated injuries which could cause the hemorrhage. Your main role is to get a good successful diagnosis and management of this injury. You require a good thorough history and physical examination, a very high-end suspicion, and rapid administration of care. The speed is crucial in management of these injuries with rapid resuscitation, complete and rapid evaluation, and urgent surgical treatment. So each individual hospital or setup where the patient is come need to have certain protocol which need to be followed so as to get the best of the results. Mostly a physical good clinical examination could give you a diagnosis, but sometimes you need to go for further investigations with this Doppler, duplex or angio so as to further diagnose your injury. But I feel if you it's most important to have a good careful physical examination and high index of suspicion will certainly give you a most important clue towards the diagnosis of this injury. Simultaneously, you need to treat this patient immediately with all replacing the blood volume loss which is happening. You need to cover the wounds, reduce the fractures or dislocation as soon as possible, splint them. You need to control the bleeding, and re-evaluation of these injuries is very important. You need to follow all the advanced trauma life care support protocols along with the systematic approach to your ABCD protocols. Your treatment should be based on injuries, then the vitals and injury mechanism. You need to certainly identify the location of this bleeding, try to stop it and restore the intravascular volume. You need to certainly maintain good functional blood composition. Initial hemograms and coagulation profiles, they are certainly indicated so as to assess the further bleeding anemia which is developing. Again, this patient will certainly further need in some of the heparin or other anticoagulants, or these things are started. So further screening with INR monitoring is very essential. So this is a very important slide where you need to understand what are the hard signs for vascular injury. Obviously, and pulseless limb is one of the hardest sign where you can diagnose it could be a vascular injury. But so you can see a major hemorrhage which is occurring, or if you can see patient is into the hypotension either because of a closed injury with expanding hematoma inside, or even a pulsating bleeding or three at the fracture site, injury site. These are all very evident hard signs where you don't need to go for further diagnosis. But sometimes if the presentation is not there, then you can go for the soft signs like asymmetrical temperatures, comparing on the both sides, asymmetrical pulses, or injury to the anatomically related nerve. History of bleeding after the injury is again important clue for the diagnosis. Again, this is a very busy slide, but here you can see these are very important things which you need to see whenever acute ischemia to the extremity is happening. 5 P's, as you already know, the pain, pallor, purselessness, paresthesia, paralysis. The color of the limb from pallor to cyanosis, then mottling could happen. The temperature will be colder as compared to the other side. There will be loss of sensory function. Numbness will progress to the anesthesia. Very important simple test which you can do is to needle prick the toes or the fingers. You can see if the bleeding is coming out or it is delayed or not. You can simply see the nail bed written, either it's slow or it is completely absent as compared to a normal side. Then cutaneous scratching so as to skin, see for the skin circulation. And this is very important of having a SpO2 to see the waveform. The percentage is not very important. To see a good waveform with good high amplitude waves is very essential for the diagnosis. So further ahead, this patient, if they are having a loss of motor function, you can certainly see that these are the limbs which are having the advanced limb-threatening ischemia. This is becomes irreversible because of the muscle turgidity. And this is very important that intrinsic foot muscles or the hand muscles, they are usually getting affected because of ischemia first. But because of their movement, which has been controlled proximally either in forearm leg, will not be able to detect them early. Certainly, various classifications are available. This is one I find very useful as to assess the extremity circulation of the acute limb ischemia with Rutherford classification. It divided into 3 categories from viable to threatened to irreversible. They are based on various clinical findings and Doppler signals. Again, this is very subjective, but still you need to, if they are presenting early, sometimes differentiation between these individual is very difficult. Certainly, if the pulses are symmetrical, you should further go ahead with soft sense evaluation. But the pulses are absent, that certainly suggests there is some muscular problem and surgical exploration is very essential. So in acal brachial index, if it is less than 0.9 with the asymmetrical pulses along with the soft signs, if it is present, it will certainly suggest that vascular ischemia is going on, especially with high energy fractures. But again, this is usually used in cases of chronic ischemia and peripheral vascular diseases where critical or chronic ischemia has to be diagnosed. And it certainly does not define the extent and level of injury. So it is very cheap, very easy, has a good negative predictive value, but again, it will have a very limited use in case of venous injuries or false positive spasm, or especially the open fractures where you cannot put down the cuffs. So this is the most important Doppler ultrasound, a handheld simple tool, which will be very essential and could give you an easy diagnosis for screening whether this patient is having vascular injury or not. A simple, good audible Doppler could signal that some amount of blood flow is certainly going on, but you need to assess the adequacy of flow. Presence of signal, again, does not mean that the patient doesn't have got arterial injury because it could be a simple monophasic flow. So for further diagnosis, you should go for Doppler duplex scanning, which could determine the triphasic proper flows. It is a non-invasive method, very safe, rapid, again, very reliable to locate the arterial or venous injuries or in chronic problems with fistulas or aneurysms. But again, it requires a technician, the scanner availability. And many a times, even surgeon will not operate even based on this single information alone. So what remains gold standard in the proper cath lab angiography? So here in angiography, you can particularly locate exactly site where the injury is happening. You can characterize the different kind of vascular injury patterns, which I have explained. You can identify the status of vessel proximally and distally, which is very important. Distally, collateral circulation formation to see on angiography is very important. And sometimes with this angiography, you can go for therapeutic intervention to correct sometimes the vascular injury problems. Again, the problems with angiography that the hypotensive or sick patient cannot be monitored inside cath lab. Sometimes it is time consuming, expensive, but then had got some procedural risk because of the dye. But I certainly feel that these are very few as compared to the advantages which you get from the angiography. And certainly this MDCT angiography certainly has got almost replacing angiography as a standard of care. As an alternative, it has again got a good sensitivity and specificity. It decreases your contrast load. Again, it is very fast, effective, cost-wise, and very easily available. But again, it cannot exclude all arterial injuries and may sometimes again, a surgeon could ask for an angiography ahead. Another method which has been described is operative angiography, a single view in operating room. Again, rapid, excellent method, but you need a hybrid kind of operation theater where the cath lab is associated. So irrespective of all these things, the simultaneous treatment of patient is very essential, reduction, stabilize resuscitation. Angiography will only delay the revascularization if you feel that you have got the evident injury, you will see the complete transaction, absent pulses. You should immediately go for surgery rather than wasting your precious time in all these procedures. So surgical exploration immediate is indicated whenever the patient is in a good time frame, which is as a right. It's a good pulseless limb having a thrill at the injury proper site. And most importantly, if you could see or identify the exact site of injury, you are not in confusion. Frank arterial injury is seen on examination and you feel that this will not be amenable to endovascular repair. So these are the indications where a surgeon could directly go for vascular repair. So this is a very good algorithm which I see that if the patient has got no pulses, if you feel that injury is obvious, location is seen, you can directly go with surgery. If there is some confusion, multi-level injury, you can go for a Doppler or angio and confirm it and then go for a surgery. With soft signs, with asymmetrical pulses, go for Doppler. If you feel ankle brachial index is less than 0.9, you can further go ahead with angiography or duplex scan and then go for surgery if you feel there is a vascular injury. So this is a simple diagram where it is predicting that if the heart signs are there, you can directly go with OT intervention if needed. If there is a time which is available, then you can certainly go ahead with other intervention as well. But with soft signs, with lesser ankle brachial index, go for angiogram if in doubt, and then explore if it is necessary. Further ahead in vascular injury is very important, not only in the first initial stage, but after these injuries are very dynamic. These are ever-changing, could go from a mild to then again in further complications. So you need to evaluate them continuously after initial injury or surgery. Additional debridement, fixation you need to undertake even after first successful revascularization has been done. You need to continuously monitor the circulation, the neurological function, the compartment syndrome, which is usually associated with this kind of injuries. So the next question sometimes in the treatment part is, who should go first, whether a vascular surgeon or orthopedic surgeon, plastic surgeon, a team is usually formed. So the this recent article has certainly suggested that the sequence of fixation either by vascular or orthopedic surgeon does not affect the amputation rate. And even it has mentioned that the traction upon even the vascular repair will not lead to much of a vascular compromise. So these are the two essential points which has come up with the injury journal article recently. So who should go first depends on, you should consult amongst each other as to which surgery takes a priority. Usually, most of the time, it is the orthopedic bone fixation which is needed, followed by a vascular surgery. But in certain cases, like in a clavicle open injury where subclavian artery is damaged, you need to repair the subclavian, then an orthopedic surgeon should go. Temporary shunt sometimes could benefit. Fracture stabilization again depends whether you go for internal or external fixation, depending on the closed or open of the injury, the amount of crush in the injury, or the time presentation of that particular present to the casualty. Certainly, you should go towards the salvage as compared to the amputation. And fasciotomies are mostly needed, especially if you suspect some compartment syndromes or if you are repairing the artery. So for treatment protocol, you need to consider individual patients as to individualize treatment for that particular case scenario rather than particularly following all those principles. You need to, ultimate aim is to restore the blood flow, debride the devitalized tissue, stabilize the fractures. Again, the compartment syndrome or this thing has very essential part which come into the vascular injury. It is because of increase in the intracompartmental pressure which impairs the tissue perfusion and could lead to tissue death. This is certainly seen in compartment syndromes or artery injury which we require repair, or combined arterial and venous injuries. So this is an example of a very unusual case of a patient who is having heavy fistula on regular dialysis with some simple needle injury. Sometimes this bleeding has occurred in the forearm and he has developed the forearm compartment syndrome, which I have released, and luckily could save his limb within a few hours. This is another rare case which I have done in the residency with a closed femoral shaft fracture, a thigh compartment syndrome. Again, not very common, but suspicion and knowing all these things is very important so as to at least predict this thing could happen and you can certainly treat them. As an example, now I will go with this leg fasciotomy, which is very essential for all orthopedic surgeons to know. This is a young male patient presented 2 hours after trauma to a casualty. Here you can see a tense, swollen leg. He is having certainly excessive pain, especially on the passive movements of the ankle. That is, a stress test is positive. He has started developing some numbness in his toes. And certainly you should not look for pulsations. If you feel the pulsations are absent in such kind of, it's too late for that compartment syndrome which is happening. So the reduced organ perfusion due to increased intra-compartment pressure in this compartment syndrome is usually seen. So there are various techniques that describe as a single incision and double incision. I usually prefer a dual incision technique, a posterior medial and an anterolateral. The posterior medial is just 2 to 3 finger breadth behind the tibial crest or near the posterior border of the tibia, and the lateral incision is usually somewhat anteriorly, anterolaterally over the fibula, where you can see this thing. So once you open up this, the length of incision, again it depends, but once you start opening up, you can see that muscles are popping out, you can sometimes see bleeding inside. You need to extend this incision. Then medially you need to decompress the superficial and deep parts of the posterior compartment. You need to identify individual muscle planes, the intermuscular septums. The gastrocnemius and soleus muscles which are there has to be clearly identified, and a plane should be developed between them. And then and the lateral aspect, again, the incision which was taken directly over the fibula, you can then further, with this incision, you need to identify the lateral intermuscular septum. So laterally, you need to decompress the anterior as well as the lateral compartment, the peroneal compartment. So anteriorly, if you incise, you will decompress the anterior compartment. You certainly need very long scissors so as to you can cut the fascia with the smallest incisions possible. You need to see for the vastus ridge, the soleal ridge, for the deep compartment on the posterior aspect so as to completely decompress the, even the deep posterior compartment properly. And here, as you can see, you sometimes may not need a complete bigger incisions so as to complete the fasciotomy. You can reach the medial valgus with just cutting the facial incisions. And then you need to identify whether each individual muscle has been completely decompressed or not. So you need to break this cycle of edema, then increase compartment pressure, reduce blood flow, ischemia by this fasciotomy technique. So this is how the wound will look after just the surgery, that you know, huge edema, will not able to close this wound. Then the second stage of this would be like the wounds will get ischemic. Certainly patient most of the time need transfusions on the second or third day. And gradually once there is no infection, wound starts healing, then they will be more vascular and ready for the grafting. So after around 8 or 9 days, when the swelling and everything has settled down, we have done the internal fixation of tibial condyle fractures with the dual plate, and the skin grafting was done simultaneously. And this is the functional outcome at the end of around 4 months. Certainly an early fasciotomy could save limb and at the end could give very good results. So we'll go back to our case scenario where multi-level injury I have shown, like a femoral fracture and tibial condyle fracture. This patient immediately undergone an angio, and we can certainly see that the injury was near the popliteal artery. So immediately he was taken in the operation theater. He came within a very golden period, around 1.5 hours after injury. He was in OT around after 2.5 hours after injury. So I could finish up all these 3 or 4 major procedures. Like I put few screws through the condyle, fixed the patella, then the tibial condyle, and finally even the femoral nailing was done so as to skeletally stabilize femur and tibia for the posterior approach where the vascular repair was done. So since he has come in between that particular time frame, so as we can get the time to internally fix all these components. So if the patient come early, you have got confidence in your setup, all other things are available, inventory is available, you should certainly go for internal fixation in such cases as well. Postoperatively, this patient would land into the reperfusion effects, as you all know, because of the systemic release of all these toxins, which could lead into the reperfusion syndrome, like the acidosis, hypotension, hyperkalemia, renal failure. So systemic, all these things needs to be monitored properly. Good intensive care is needed. Sometimes it is also recommended this sometimes become irreversible in few of the cases where ligation of vessel is sometimes needed irrespective of the supportive measures which you have taken. But this was the same case where done the prophylactic fasciotomy. Even you can see gradually the wounds have started healing, the edema has subsided, and it certainly saves from reperfusion injury. Gradually the wounds were primarily closed at around 15 days, and you can see the complete good range of movement with a good functional recovery at the end of 4th month for this case. So we'll go to the second case scenario, which I showed like a good degloving injury, and we have done the angiography. As you can see in the angiography, though this patient came within 1 hour, she was having some shock initially, but somehow she was able to resuscitate her properly. An immediate angio was done, showing the block near the femoral artery. So after consultation with a proper vascular surgeon and with plastic surgeon and all the intensivist anesthetist, decision for limb salvage had chosen for this patient, and we just put the extant fixator for femur, done the vascular repair, and the flap of the skin which was a degloving was just created to cover the wound. Immediately second, third day, you can see patient certainly start feeling well, her parameters were improving. We certainly need to consult this patient because these are very unpredictable injury. Further course, nobody knows. We need to continuously, closely monitor such kind of patient. And we got a good window period at around fourth day where we could fix his her left tibial fracture with this tibia nail. And then further ahead, you need to have a review assessments of this wound and the systemic effects which are happening. Daily dressings under anesthesia is planned in the OT. But unfortunately, on around 8 or 9 days, she has started deteriorating with ongoing necrosis. She has limb started showing ischemia. And she was just landing up into the DIC or early septicemia, where we could see even the wound is not getting better. So we decided to go for an urgent bone amputation on the 11th day. After giving that trial, we could at least maintain the good amount of stem length here, and it could cover good with the skin cover itself. And this is her recovery at the end of 6 months. She has just started, her left tibia fracture has united well. She has just started on training, and a prosthetic limb has been applied to this patient. So good positive mental attitude, good counseling, continuous monitoring, and a good rehabilitation. Even could get further results in such kind of vascular injuries. Now there are a few other examples which I'd like to highlight. Like this is a tibial condyle fracture, very innocuous looking, not a very good displaced fracture. But if you can see, the trajectory of fracture is a transverse kind of fracture line, if you can see. And there is a fracture in the fibular head as well. That is around a transverse laceration which was happening. And in angio, if you could see that the particular vessel is just getting blocked near that particular site itself. So as you can see, the fibular head and then the popliteal artery. So we immediately explored the wound. We luckily found that the peroneal nerve was intact. We just decompressed it. We done the popliteal repair. And then simultaneously, the tibial fixation along with the fibular head fixation was also done in this patient. Gradually, the wound started healing, and there was no further infection. And this is at the end of 6 months, the fracture has completely recovered. Peroneal now, there was only partial recovery, complete recovery was not there. But somehow he is able to get maximum good function at the end of 6 months. This is another case of a penetrating deep laceration injury. Here you can see there is already having operated previous femur nail inside, and it is 6 hours from the injury when he presented to us. So on further, even the examination, you can directly see that there is an open MCL as well as meniscal as well as the condyle, both condyle, femoral tibial condyle with the medial collateral is gone. And obviously you can directly pinpoint the vascular popliteal injury through this wound itself. So further, the debridement was done, popliteal repair along with the extant fixation was thus done in the first stage. When the limb is revascularized, then further fixation of tibial and the femoral condyle fragments along with MCL reconstruction was done in this patient. And certainly we could get again a good alignment and good stability with this patient. So there are few cases which could present late, like this patient had an injury around 12 hours back when he presented. His distal pulses were completely absent. As you can see, there is a massive amount of crush with ipsilateral tibial and femoral fracture with multiple wounds. Luckily, he has got good toe movements, ankle movements, and good sensation. Though NBR has delayed and cold extremity is there. So we need to identify whether this limb is viable or getting more unviable for further salvage or not. This where his x-rays, as you can see, there is a massive segmental tibial bone loss along with massively crushed femur. So we have done is angiography. This will assess the extremity circulation. Luckily in angio now you will see that is a good feeling at the femoral side, and the injury was seems to be somewhere around the TBL, but somehow the distal flow is also there. So on further digital subtraction angiography, which is very important tool, so as to assess the distal collateral circulation. In this is the plantar arch, if you can see a good amount of plantar arch with the posterior tibial artery was developing. So if you further see in this angio, this is refilling good with the single vessel from the posterior tibial artery, then the plantar arch is forming, and even the retrograde circulation you can certainly find out. So this limb is somehow surviving with whatever the circulation is having. So we decided not to go for any further vascular intervention. We just wait and watch for some 2 or 3 days. Then we had done the first intervention of the tibial fixation. The external fixation was done. Then in the second stage, the femoral fixation with massive grafting was done. Then tibia needed, as you know, Elizaro ring frame was initially applied, but it failed. Then vascularized fibula graft was done. And then this is final union at the tibia, and patient somehow developed Volcom ischemic contractures with ankle equinus deformity, for which the ankle orthodosis fusion nail was done. But somehow the limb survived. It's good, stable limb, is able to walk on it and do most of the activities. This is another very interesting case of a grinder belt injury presented around 4 hours after injury. As you can see, the wound was sutured over there. Once we open it, there was an obviously axillary artery injury because the pulsations were not absent, and the patient was having mainly a ipsilateral shaft humerus as well as distal humerus fracture. So that axillary artery was immediately repaired. His wound was debrided. The limb was stabilized initially, and further second, we have plated the shaft humerus as well as the distal humerus. And again, we could get a good, even as you can see, there was a deltoid muscle injury itself, which was also repaired, and wound healing and good result were seen in this case. And as you noted that the site of vascular injury is different and the fractures are different in this case scenario. Then the next case is the gunshot injury. If you could see over here, it's an anteromedial kind of this gunshot injury, where you can see it has caused the tibial condyle as well as femoral HOFA kind of fracture, along with lateral collateral ligament injury, and it was crushing the popliteal artery. So in the first stage itself, fixator along with this gunshot wound debridement was done, and then plastic surgery, popliteal artery repair was done. These gunshot injuries are gradually evolving injuries. On second or third week, we started getting all this track, the deeper tissues getting necrosis, multiple debridement. Somehow at the end of 1 month, this wound has started some signs of healing. And after that, we had decided to go for the fracture fixation with this multiple screw fixation for distal femoral fractures and tibial condyle fracture, even his lateral ligamentous complex was repaired. We could get a good stable knee, but some of the range of movement was only 0 to 50 degrees. But again, there were no further infection, and he is happy with the current range of movements at the moment, considering the amount of crush which is present in this contral injuries associated with these fractures. This is the next example. Again, a blunt injury, rollover injury. Again, distal pulsation was absent. Immediate angio was done. Somehow with angio embolization, we could get back the pulsations. This patient we watched for around 7 days. Then a MIPO distal, this MIPO technique, tibial plate fixation was done. So even these low kind of injuries, even in older patients, could sometimes happen. We need to just anticipate them, see them, and even this could get you into the good results at the end. This is a very unusual and a very different case, and got a very good different experience for me. Like, this is a father of my colleague doctor who presented in casualty just 1 hour after the trauma. And he is keeping his knee flex. He is unable to extend it. He is in severe pain. So we suspected some kind of unstable femoral or tibial condyle fracture with patella or some knee kind of dislocation. And with this, he was also having absent pulses on the right low limb, all dorsal dispersion, even that was absent. So very difficult to assess this patient further ahead. Only what we can do is to get a good lateral x-ray, where you can see that patient was having a lateral dislocation of patella. And you can see some fracture in the, it's a medial dislocation of patella as well as some fracture in the tibial condyle. So this is only a view which was possible, which was done, and certainly we need further delineation and CT and further things to proceed ahead. But he was in such a severe pain, we have just given him some anesthesia in the casualty itself, and knee, the patella dislocation was reduced, and knee was straight, made straight in extension. And somehow after 5 or 10 minutes, the pulses have started reappearing. So there must have been some simple compression because of this injury, and then the pulses must have appeared. And then further evaluation, this patient was only having a tibial condyle fracture, as you can see over here, along with a lateral retinaculum of the patella, which was torn. So then further ahead, he got with the surgery of this tibial condyle and patellar retinaculum fixation. Unfortunately for him, he landed into the infection, a frank infection. Plate has to be removed after around 15 days. We put the bag, we gone for the antibiotic beads, we have put this frame. And we could find out the cause of infection was because of a large hematoma. If you could see the drain, which was proximally, so from there a good amount of hematoma which was collected in the initial injury, which has got the pus collection over there, which was causing all these things. So it was slightly delayed thing which we have noticed, but somehow debrided, somehow this patient, the infection was well under control. He was ambulated, a good physiotherapy, further nutrition, he was mobilized. And this is how at the end of almost 1 year, he could get a good range of movement. So sometimes these injuries take unpredictable course, and when we can have a very different learning experience in individual case scenarios, and every complication will make you learn something. Another case of a floating, very massively crushed injury, especially in around 50 years old obese lady. Again, popliteal injury, which was repaired, X-piece was applied. This was her final fixation after 1 month, which was done. Another very interesting case, as you can see, this gentleman has presented after around 2 hours of trauma to us with a clavicle fracture, as you can see, and distal pulsations, and his shoulder function was weak, abduction is particularly limited. So with this kind of X-ray, we're suspecting such a massively displaced clavicle fracture, which is compressing on the subclavian artery, and some kind of brachial plexus traction injury was suspected. So immediately, there is no point in waiting after angio confirmation that there is a subclavian artery which was damaged. Immediate exploration was done. This subclavian artery, if you could see, it is completely contused over there. So these are the further pictures, if you could see better. This was a complete contused segment because of the clavicle fragment which are displaced. Luckily, brachial plexus were all intact. There were no injuries. This is how that complete resection of that contused segment was done. This is the thrombus which was occluding. Even the vessel wall is damaged because of that vascular injury. And we just done the repair with a resection anastomosis with a venous graft over there. And the circulation was improved. Luckily, brachial plexus was not injured as already told. And then the further clavicle fixation was done with a plate over there. These are his post-operative X-rays, as you can see. And luckily, urgent management is the key over here. He can get a good function of this clavicle as well as gradually. He has got a full neurological recovery even at the end of 1 year. Very rare to say in brachial plexus. Since we could anatomically see that there was no brachial plexus which was involved, good subclavian artery vascular anastomosis done and a good clavicle fixation would sometimes give a good result even in these cases. Another case of an elbow dislocation, again a very unusual kind of posterior medial kind of dislocation this patient was having. And if you could say, there is a fracture in the lateral condyle of the humerus along with lateral ligamentous complex instability which was there. So obviously the distal pulsations were not there, and you can see that brachial artery is completely lacerated. You can see the amount of injury, it was completely lacerated, and then further this was completely repaired with a venous graft in between. And then with the same approach, immediate surgery for the lateral condyle fixation with a screw along with the anchors. The inventory must be available. You must anticipate if these things can certainly provide you a good immediate final fixation, even from the orthopedic point of view, from the same incision which you are taking. Another case of a side swipe injury, young female having a crushed elbow, as you can see, all distal humerus and proximal things were completely crushed with a badly contaminated wound. Initially it was debrided, the vascular injury was there on the brachial side, which was explored and repaired. We put her on the external fixator in the initial stage. Gradually all the wounds started healing after around 1.5 to 2 months. Bone have started settling, there was no infection then, and grafting was done. And for such a kind of bad elbow, only option which would have remained is the elbow replacement, which we had done. And at the end of around 6 months from the initial injury, she could have a good functional range of movement as far as considered his left elbow. And we could salvage her joint with a good movement for the rest. Then this is another good example, like again the distal humerus fracture comminuted even in CT. It was diagnosed to have this complete laceration. It was a closed injury. Forearm was already getting into the compartment syndrome. These two incisions can show the amount of pressure which initially we see it to. It has to the whether these things are viable or not. And then on further exploration, the same incision, again a humerus fixation was done. The brachial artery and further exploration was done. Again, it was repaired with an venous graft. So same surgical approach for orthopedic as well as this vascular fixation. Luckily, such a big wound with this swelling has somehow gradually disappeared, and we could primarily close this wound with a good amount of bone union happening at the humerus site. Another case, again, like a degloving kind of injury presented 7 days after injury to us, and she was having some kind of ischemic hand. As you can see, only a few skin is available on the other side. So we could not able to palpate the pulses, but on angiography, its limb was surviving on the radial flow itself. There was no ulnar flow, and some dampened radial flow with a good palmar arch circulation is seen. So we decided to salvage this limb in the upper limb. So we have done initial debridements with VAC application. She was having ipsilateral humerus fracture, which was fixed. Then she was having distal radius and ulna fracture on the same side. And as you can see, very difficult to put implants without having much covering. Still, I could put a plate initially, so as to just stabilize the thing. And then a grafting was done on this wound after these fixations. And these are the further x-rays. And as you can see, she has started developing the flexion contracture. And we had to revise the fixation of this plate and then grafted it. And then we could properly cover it after this grafting was done. And somehow at the end of around 5 months of all of this exercise, we could able to salvage her limb with some amount of supination and pronation and some amount of wrist flexion extension and good stability at the hand could be achieved. Another case of a crushed leg injury. Here you can see massive crush in the leg muscles as well as anterior tibial was completely lacerated. So on exploration, it was quite retracted. So limb was very well surviving on the other posterior tibial circulation. So this artery was ligated. We had done the debridement. And we had immediately, in spite of such a big open wound, we had done immediately the closed intermedullary nailing was done. We could get a good alignment, and then wound was loosely approximated. And it's very essential that in the second day itself, they went for the flap surgery, like a rotational flap along with the skin grafting was done to cover this wound. So this is how at the end of around 4 months, all of this graft is been taken up, no infection. The fracture has started uniting. So internal fixation, in spite of sometimes open fracture, if you are confident that you could manage to cover these open wounds with the team available, this kind of modality should always be thought of. Another case example of a slightly obese young male having a brachial artery injury with this kind of fracture. This kind of spike was causing some kind of compression. Luckily, with endovascular procedure, the pulses has reappeared. As you can see, it's quietly obese, and luckily the pulses have appeared. So after that, immediately we went for the this proper supracondylar humerus fracture fixation with this dual column plating with olecranon osteotomy was done. Actually, we could get a good reduction and good union at the end of 6 months, and you can certainly see that he has got a good range of movement with all these things possible. Another case, like this patient was presented 20 hours after his tibial condyle injury, and somehow the limb is still surviving, maybe with the collateral circulation which was happening. And on angio, there was some thrombosis. So immediately it was explored, the thrombus, and the segment was completely taken out. It was initially fixed with an external fixator, and the pulses immediately started reappearing after this surgery. So somehow we could save this limb. His wound luckily got healed very well. Grafting was done, the fixator was taken out, and plating was done. So in spite sometimes presenting late with a good collateral circulation, with good muscles, a younger patient, sometimes we could get such results even in the late presentations. another patient with a tibial condyle injury. As you can see, there was a complete block of the popliteal artery near the tibial condyle. Again, this presented late, around 10 hours. He was having foot drop already, peroneal nerve palsy because of ischemia rather than injury itself, which was seeming. But still, she wanted to take a chance. They explained everything as to she could have a non-functional insensate limb, but she wanted to go ahead. So internal fixation with tibial condyle fracture was done in the initial stage. And then later on, she developed the foot drop with ankle equinus contracture. The arthrodesis region ankle was also done. But as you can see, she is having unstable knee. She is certainly awaiting further for the ACL surgery. ACL ligament repair needs to be done. So sometimes we can certainly cannot prevent the neurological complication which has already occurred, and its recovery is very unpredictable, especially in cases of such an ischemia. Another very simple, unusual case, unusual tibial plafond kind of fracture. Only finding was our limb is all good. Only finding dorsalis pedis was not palpable. So if you could see this fracture pattern, this anterior fragment has displaced. And intraoperatively, after exploration, you can see that vessel was just compressing because of that fragment. Just when I lifted and separated that fragment, isolated the vessel, almost the circulation has immediately appeared. Again, this is a very crushed kind of tibial plafond fracture along with graft and then multiple screws. This was fixed. And it is sometimes easy for that vascular injury, but somehow we could get a good reduction of the ankle joint as well and a good function afterwards. So if in doubt, I would recommend sometimes the patients coming late, whether the limb is viable or not. A very simple effective method which I would like to highlight is a fasciotomy which you can do in the casualty itself. This is because the patient sometimes will have an insensate limb, will not be able to feel. This is a very small incision you can take and just see the muscles from that incision, whether they are bleeding, there are any contractility in the muscle. So that will guide you as to whether you will certainly go ahead for further salvage in these patients or not. So this is a simple, effective 5-minute procedure which can be tried in casualty. And certainly, if the patients are certainly presented very late, where already the ischemia is happening, all the systemic signs are happening, so there is no further alternative to go for the amputation. The level you need to decide upon the site of crush of injury or the vascular level. And this is again more common, may not come to the orthopedic surgeon, like sharp injuries without any fractures. Again, 10 to 15% of cases could occur because of these wounds. Again, if they are presenting late, sometimes you need to go for amputation. Another very unusual injury by a saw machine. If you could see, there is an incomplete fracture which has happened because of that. Anterior tibial artery was injured. So they repaired it with a vascular anastomosis. Luckily for bone, we didn't do anything. This incomplete saw injury gradually healed up on its own at the end of 6 months. Then another very interesting is like sometimes patient come with the sutured wound. As you can see, this wound was sutured and she was not having the pulsation in the radius and there were no finger movements. So just on exploration, you can just find out there are so many things which have been torn inside, which were not properly documented and seen. And then you need to, along with the plastic surgeon, all the radial artery was repaired and the individual tendon repairs were also done in such kind of thing. So these closed wounds carried almost anything inside. So few cases were already severe crush and unable to reconstruct with such a massive crush injury. The fate is itself decided by the trauma itself, and you cannot do much, at least in for such cases. You should certainly go for some mangle extremity score and attempt to limb salvage. You can document each patient as to the age, then mechanism, then various scores if you could do, and the result, they should be documented so as to have the level of success which you could achieve in these patients, at least in your setup. But certainly scoring systems are useful. There are so many things which are explained. The Ganga, they have their own mangle extremity severity score. And these are the other scores that should be applied at the time of initial evaluation, but they do not provide any guiding principle to make the further decisions. So they are certainly sometimes very complex and subjective with various inter-observed variation. But certainly the true function ultimately lies with the overall result which we gave and the satisfaction to the patient. And certainly this is very important. You should try to salvage the limb, not at a very bad financial cost. Like if patient lands up ultimately late amputation, not a good functional limb, returning to work after so many days, and that is even a non-functional limb. So sometimes better to take the in amputation, make a good prosthesis that could certainly save a lot of cost for this patient. So this point should always be considered in cases of limb salvage which you have proceeded for. Certainly microsurgical techniques have improved success. Majority grades and unprotected likenesses, you should not try to take a decision of amputation at the initial itself, evaluation itself. You should be confident to take final decision compared to whatever team experience, skills, consultations which you are having. Scoring, certain scoring system certainly should be used as a guide to supplement that person's surgical clinical judgment and experience. So for the prognostic factors, with all these cases which I explained, it all depends on the level and kind of vascular injury that patient is having, the amount of collateral circulation which has been developed in this kind of patient, the soft tissue crush which is already happening, the presence of associated or multiple injuries and the comorbid conditions with this patient. Finally, I will go with this important thing which usually can happen with the vascular injury after elective surgeries. Like this is a very unpleasant complication of a vascular surgery could occur in orthopedics, and certainly it invites a lot of...
Manoj, how many slides are there? We can have some discussion because it is becoming too monotonous.
Okay.
Yeah. How many slides are there about this vascular surgeries after elective surgeries, approximately?
15 to 20, I suppose.
Okay. Anyway, you can stop sharing the screen. We'll have some discussion right now.
Okay.
Because you are, before even the Samruddhi mark between Bombay and Nagpur, you are going at a bullet train speed, very, very fast. And we had no opportunity to interrupt you also all this time. Let's have some discussion. So let me start. There are a few cases where you showed that the patient had a vascular injury sort of thing, like the TY fracture of the elbow or the ankle, where after opening, it was only the bony fragment which was causing the compression and there was no real vascular injury. So in such cases, have you done any vascular studies or have you kept a vascular surgeon as standby? You can stop sharing the screen for some time.
Yeah, just
yes, so that all the panelists will be seen properly at the screen. If you are unable to do, I will do it from my side. No problem.
You can just stop sharing, sir.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I couldn't get your question, like the vascular injury,
yeah. Two cases you have shown where there was no actual vascular injury, but the fragment were pressing on the vessel and temporarily there was a distal pulsations were not seen. But yeah. Did you operate them with a vascular surgeon as standby or did you operate yourself as a general orthopedic surgeon or did you carry out any investigative measures like vascular studies or Doppler studies before operating these cases?
Usually, I go for functional proper cath lab angiography of all these patients before operating. The interventional radiology is usually gives them a good guide as to the what kind of vascular compression it is. And if with some endovascular procedure or with simple compression sometimes, if he is able to show that the limb is good, viable with good vascularity, and if I am confident that I will not be manipulating too much during this injury, and will not cause much of the trauma, then certainly I will proceed with the surgery as soon as possible. And then postoperatively, again, we can evaluate because preoperatively I have documented that the limb is viable, the pulsations have appeared with whatever procedure which you have done. And once we are confident on that, then you can go first postoperatively, you can certainly assess whether surgery has itself per se caused another confounding factor for these vascular injuries ahead.
Okay. Yes. Any questions from other panelists? Yes, Latish.
Yeah. Manoj, it was as Sarah told, it was like going in bullet speed, and his endurance has to be congratulated. 1 hour has been made the same tempo.
Yeah.
And he has discussed a lot of cases, and maybe I feel he's quite a famous surgeon. He gets all the cases within 1.5 hours of time. So maybe the fixation part. I differ, but most of the time we want the orthopedician to go for an external fixator than an internal fixation when it comes to an vascular injury cases, because time is a crucial thing in that. And in a dislocation or in a fracture, which is a close fracture, which we suspect a vascular injury. We always do a Doppler study to know exactly if it is a single bone. If it is a multi-level fracture, we always go for a CT angiogram because we want to know where exactly the level of fracture or the block has happened. And it is always good that you have a vascular team supporting you. Not that you fix it, then you lose a time of 1.5 hours, 2 hours, and then you come to know that there is a vascular occlusion or it's not flown. And then you call in the vascular surgeon, again, you're going to lose another 1 hour. So the golden time is going to be lost. So for an orthopedician who's dealing with this, which a fracture with a vascular problem, I think better is to have always a vascular surgeon's backup.
Absolutely correct. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Yes, Harry. Yeah.
The other thing is our always preference is to do the fixation first and then do the vascular repair, as he also presented in many cases, because that way you got a solid foundation and a quick X-fix in case of limbs and clavicle fixation in case of shoulder always makes it much more comfortable. Though we have done vascular repair first and then done, as he also rightly mentioned, traction as such does not cause, because if you put a vein graft, it is quite flexible. It won't go off so fast. But the only thing is, if you revascularize, and then if there is not much connection there, there can be a lot of bleeding. So because you have revascularized the limb and you don't have the venous outcome. So one mention which was not there, was that we always try to do the major vein also if it is cut, because otherwise you can have torrential bleed when you are trying to fix it. And preferably do it under tourniquet at a higher level so that you can do and his point of putting an incision and checking for the muscle is very important. But the whole dilemma comes, I think the whole discussion is on the gray zone, as you rightly mentioned. Yeah. Either you miss it on the initial fixation, or they come to us late, as Latish pointed out. For us also, they come pretty late. So the average time, most of the patients in India come between 3 to 6 hours. And when they come between 3 to 6 hours, if you send for angio and if you do fixation, and if you calculate the revascularization time, it is just borderline between 6 to 10 hours. And that is where you get into problem. And always you will find that the most VIP patient and the most important patient you want to salvage, like a young girl or a patient, they will only have longer ischemia time and get into problem. So as you rightly said, you presented actually all scenarios. I think there are a lot of take-home messages, maybe a lot of papers in your presentation. Like, we need to tell the patient, number one, be prepared for the complication. And the complication are basically, it can go for amputation in the next 48 hours. I think that is number one complication. Be ready for any systemic problems, which we try to anticipate and prevent. And second, we always tell them that foot drop and anterior compartment revascularization is always going to be very poor. So they have to be either prepared for a tendon transfer and or ankle fusion, as you rightly presented. Most of the time, even though the posterior tibial nerve is ischemic, but we have found that in the long term, the posterior tibial nerve sensation recovers. And in some cases, if you do a TA lengthening and do a posterior tibial neurolysis, they all invariably get protective sensation. So sensory part is not an indication for amputation. I think in our series of 150 cases, which are just written up, the commonest cause of a secondary amputation is a loss of or a lack of soft tissue cover. So if you're not able to cover the vessels, they slough out, or they have a blowout, or the fractures don't unite because of your loss of soft tissue cover, that is what ends up into problem. Delayed ischemia is not actually a major cause of secondary amputation. Right?
Yeah. Can you also elaborate on the level? How do you decide the level of amputation if you want? Like sometimes the people will not advocate for the knee disarticulation as well.
Right. So most of the popliteal artery injury will have gastrocnemius, viable gastrocnemius. So most of the popliteal artery injury, we will try to save the knee joint. But if it is higher level, then femoral artery, and then we go for the fracture level. Very rarely we have done knee disarticulation with an interlock nailing of the femur, just to maintain the length. But with current day processes, we use Ottobock exclusively most of the time in our patients. Our Ottobock people always say that it is better to have little higher level and rather than going. So very rarely, I think in the last 10 years, we have not done a knee disarticulation at all. It has to be either above knee just above the fracture site or at the fracture site if it is a femoral fracture. Okay. If the femoral fracture is very high, then we try to maintain the length of the femur by either plating or a retrograde nail. But as much as possible, try to preserve the knee joint.
Yes.
Again, the stump length in cases of the below knee
amputation. They can fit it even 10 centimeters of below knee with a good quadriceps. They can fit a process.
Yeah.
It's possible.
Yes. Ajinkya or Saumadeep, anything to add?
Yes, sir.
Then I'll come back to Gurpal. Yes, Ajinkya.
Manoj sir, first of all, I would like to thank you for this comprehensive lecture. You have covered all the scenarios and all the concepts of traumatic vascular injury. Just to mention few points, in a pre-surgical setup, when a patient is seen somewhere at village level by some doctor, a tourniquet can be applied if there is a spurter of blood. That means a vessel is injured, so tourniquet can be applied in that case. Regarding foot drop sign, the foot drop sign, if we have excluded the blunt trauma to the nerve, that is tibial or femoral lateral condyle fracture resulting into neuropraxia to this thing, lateral popliteal nerve. If there is a foot drop sign, then we can suspect that the muscles are not working. And in that case, the revascularization may not help. Another point, if there is an open knee injury, that means the knee joint is open, there is a high risk of vascular injury. And if there is a segmental fracture, I have seen there is a less risk of vascular injury in case of segmental fracture. And one more thing, if it is an early scenario, then internal fixation I would prefer, or my orthopedician would prefer. But if it is late injury or late presentation, in that case, external fixator should be used because of edema and the compartment syndrome going to be there later on. So these are my points. Thank you.
Manoj, what about that Ajinkya told about if there is a spurter to apply tourniquet, whether you prefer to apply bandage over the wound or apply a tourniquet higher up?
It's like even I sometimes advocate to just put a artery, or if you could identify it and just wrap the wound, even that sometimes help. Then sometimes some kind of ishmar bandages, which our orthopedic surgeons are very fond of. So even if that is applied over the wound, sometimes can help. And ultimately, tourniquet, whatever compression which they could achieve, but simply wrapping of something over that limb, could sometimes save the excessive bleeding because of all this thing which is happening.
Yeah. Okay. Yes.
Dr. Ajinkya is saying is with segmental fractures, the high energy fractures, the vascular injuries are not that common.
Yes. Because the energy is more dissipated to break the bone, and the length and everything is maintained in the limb. Have you seen anything like that?
There is a circumferential contusion over that area, and this certainly the soft tissue covering around that floating middle shaft fragment would be much hampered and could give rise to more injuries, especially the vascular. Maybe Dr. Hari could comment on this.
You are muted, Hari.
What exactly you wanted me to answer? The nature of?
With segmental fractures, the vascular injuries are more or same incidence with segmental fractures,
the injuries are less. We find most commonly in our series that it is tibial plateau fracture and knee dislocations. Because the reason why popliteal injury happens, because the popliteal artery has fixed at two levels. One at the soleal level, distally, and proximally as it comes out from the adductor canal. These are the two fixed points, and they cannot move. So that is what knee dislocation commonly causes maximum damage, because it just goes, comes back, and there will be either a thrombus in continuity or even divided vessel. And second is tibial plateau fracture, where the sharp end goes and cuts. Very rarely we find femoral segmental fracture has got higher incidence of vascular injury as compared to, because one of the end would have just gone because of the crush element. Very rarely we have found tibial plateau not very rare, but compared to other levels, tibial segmental fractures are much less in causing vascular injury.
According to the current OTA guidelines, which I have read, the segmental fracture is categorized as one of the important risk factors to develop vascular injury.
But maybe compartment syndrome and the soft tissue contusion and crush is much more in a segmental fracture.
Yes. Let me come to Gurpal. Yes. Any comments, Gurpal, and any questions to the speaker? Yes.
Thank you. First of all, congratulations, Manoj. This is a fantastic talk. It brought me back to my FRCS days.
And,
thank you very much for a very comprehensive and the cases you showed. And congratulations on the outcomes that you have achieved. I think for those of us who have dealt with cases like that, we all know that this is not easy. And congratulations on that. I just want to ask you, what I find is, okay, I must admit that being in the private sector now, I'm dealing with less of these kind of cases. And I'm actually looking forward to your last segment of your talk. And I was a little bit, that was the one I'm looking forward to the most, the elective orthopedics, because that's where I deal with these issues most. And the medico-legal aspect, especially here, is very, 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 significant. So thank you for that take-home message. I just have one point or question, which again, you did bring up. I think, you brought up the point that the innocuous injuries sometimes are the worst ones. And I think Dr. Hari has just reinforced that point. So may I ask you, or maybe we can just have a short discussion before we proceed. What do you do for that innocuous knee dislocation, no fracture, that comes and you find that, there's a little bit of asymmetry in the pulses? I find these kind of cases are the most treacherous and the ones that will come back and bite you medico-legally if you are not careful, or if some, unassuming resident decides to, discharge the patient and not observe the patient. Maybe, I think for the sake of the viewers who are, a little bit more junior, maybe this would be a good discussion just to have in a couple of minutes. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like for knee dislocation, the bolder rule is that unless and until proved otherwise, you should suspect a vascular injury because the incidence is almost 40%, which has been quoted. So you need to make all the attempts to see the vascular injury is there or not. Simply pulse examination, then the ankle brachial pressure indexes. Still, if you are suspicious, you can continuously monitor the waveforms with SpO2, all these probes in attached. And sometimes, usually what happens in the knee dislocation, there is only vascular contusion, only intimal flap sometimes could get damaged and later on thrombosis and then could further land into the vascular injuries at the later course of time, we could just find them. So maybe a good CT or angio, sometimes, again, I would ideally like to go for a functional angio, but if you could document good pulsations, good anti-brachial pressure, ankle brachial pressure index, good SpO2 waveform, you can only go for a CT angio if you want. And if the patient certainly, again, further lands up into some kind of this brachial pressure index getting less than 0.9, or a patient starting developing some signs of ischemia, then you can go for this angiography as well.
So can I actually, thank you for that answer. I think, ironically, it becomes easier to make a decision when, let's say, the pulse is absent or, there's a big asymmetry between the pulses. So for that case that it's almost the same, the pulses are almost equal. Maybe, you are imagining a bit of asymmetry, but when you look at the mechanism of injury, you're a bit, I'll make it a bit more specific. Would you externally fix, or would you use some kind of cast like a back slab? How long would you admit the patient and observe? And number three, what is your investigation of choice? Is it angiography, CT angio? And what would be the timing of your investigation? And would you routinely start any anti-thrombotics or anti sort of coagulants in this case?
Yeah. Again, it all depends on the whether the patient is, again, having a high-risk kind of obese kind of patient with a gross, depending on the X-ray, if it is a very gross dislocation which was reduced, then I certainly put him into the external fixator. Certainly, the easiest way is to get the handheld Doppler and a good Doppler duplex scanning. If you could feel the pulsations, only if there is asymmetry, Doppler examination along with these things and observation for further 3 to 7 days is indicated. In the meantime, you can certainly go for CT angio if you feel, and if still the doubt persists, the gold standard certainly remains angiography.
And I'm hinting more at the intimal thrombosis and the timing of when intimal thrombosis sets in. And so does that sort of, you know, because I find that these are the most innocuous and these are the ones that bring on the most medical legal problems, at least in our setting.
Thank you. In our system, what we follow is that any person, first you put a Doppler, as he said, first you put a pulse oximeter and see for the waveform. If the waveform is absent and there is a big ecchymosis around the popliteal fossa and there is no pulse, we run along the femoral. Just above the popliteal artery, you run the Doppler and the Doppler signal stops. We always prefer to put an external fixator, then make the patient semi-prone and then explore. Yeah. So the worst thing you can have is a very, touch wood, we have never had a false exploration. There'll always be some injury. Now, depending on the injury, you decide on table whether you want to cut and resect and put a vein graft, because most of the time when there is an intimal injury, there is always going to be progression and it'll always block later on. So for intimal injury, there is no role of embolectomy. So we excise it and put a small vein graft, or if it can come directly with mobilization, that is the normal sequence we follow.
Right. So like
do angiography, because if you see all these things,
yeah.
So better to go for an angio also, just yes, to just get a good diagnosis. So, I suppose.
So if you have good access to angio and the time limit is not much, there are two situations we prefer angio. One, if the time limit is very short and you have access in your own institute, and we always give a block. We give a femoral block so that the patient is pain-free. Under a block, the patient accompanied by a resident goes for the angio and then comes back quickly. So that is one scenario. Second scenario, when they come late, so between 12 hours to 24 hours, a dislocation which has been reduced in a peripheral center, then refer to you. Now you are in a dilemma. There is no pulse, but there is some movement of the toes. So at that situation, it is always nice to have an angio, which will show you good collaterals. The dilemma is, when it is good collaterals at 12 hours, what do you do? Do you revascularize or wait? So again, that will depend upon how good is the distal perfusion and collaterals. We have had situation, we have waited, but invariably when you wait, they will usually go in for an anterior compartment, either a fibrosis or a necrosis. If you put an external fixator, you have to be careful not to put into the anterior compartment, because invariably if you put in an anterior compartment, later on you will find that the muscle now is exposed to outside, it can start discharging from the anterior compartment. So we prefer to put the tibial pins on the subcutaneous border. So that the two situations you can do angio. Definitely angio done very quickly, very nicely in your own.
You will have a proper documentation of angio that will save you from any unnecessary legal hassles which could happen in such patients as Dr. Gurpal is mentioning and
another situation, if there is a good collaterals and it is 12 hours, you can still revascularize, as he presented one case where revascularization can be done little later. But if it is total cutoff, no backflow, and 12 to 24 hours, that gives you a justification of amputation. So both ways, angio is must. Nowadays, I think angio is must. It's just like the question used to be MRI for brachial plexus. Now we prefer always MRI, because the investigation has also become better, faster, quicker, and you get more information on it.
So I fully agree. In our context, when we have a setting like that, we activate the vascular surgeon immediately. We have a very low threshold for external fixation.
Yes.
And the vascular surgeon often resorts to doing an on-table, either angio or exploration with bypass, whatever it is, and the threshold is very low. But yes, we manage with the vascular surgeon from the word go, and almost all the time we end up externally fixing them. But I that point was a very valid point, that we should avoid the anterior compartment. Thank you for that. We put the pins usually on the medial, on the subcutaneous side. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
There is a question from Dr. R.M. Chandak from your own town. Can we use Tourique in patient where pulse is not palpable, but Doppler shows wave pattern? Is that safe? probably when you are operating, if the probably that question is because he's only written that much. Can we use tourniquet in patient where pulse is not palpable but Doppler shows wave pattern? Is that safe?
Again, that handheld Doppler only with the sounds, I think only we could determine whether the circulation is there or not. But certainly it will not exclude the vascular injury. It has to be proper track flow documented in a proper color Doppler scan study, where exactly then only you will be able to locate the exact location of that injury.
The question is use of tourniquet. We routinely use tourniquet when you are exploring the vascular injury. If you are doing for fixation, then if you are careful enough, you can avoid it. But if you are exploring for the vascular injury, we use tourniquet.
Okay. Yeah. There is another question from Dr. Chanda Kundli. Do you start heparin or low molecular weight heparin or aspirin post-op in such cases?
I think after vascular injury, we certainly start on fractionated heparin. For initial, again, depending on the type of injury, but certainly we need to start on some anticoagulants. Well, mostly I will start with fractionated heparin and then put him on the warfarin ahead.
Okay. Dr. Milind Joshi from Solapur wants to know about, he wants you to talk about pseudo-aneurysm post-operatively happening. Pseudo-aneurysm.
Okay, so that is one of the complication, vascular complication, which can occur, which I have seen in the distal femoral fractures most commonly, as I just see shown in the, one of the cases as well, like that walking fragment was compressing and causing some laceration of that particular vessel, which was initially missed, and gradually that vascular injury will later on present with a gradually expanding swelling, which was very painful, tender, and gradually expanding. So this kind of presentation will like to make you one of the diagnoses of some vascular problem, which is very unusual, but still be suspected for aneurysm. Then for the further documentation, you have to go for a CT angio or better to go for an angio over there. And sometimes even our international radiologists can sometimes just fill in that aneurysm if sometimes it is possible. Or if it is not amenable for that endovascular repair, then certainly exploration and then cutting off all these aneurysm sac, which is usually compressing, and then depending on that inner vascular repair should be done.
Okay.
The only message is that if there is a swelling in a patient who has had a fracture, don't put a needle inside. You always do an ultrasound. In ultrasound itself, they can identify it as a vascular, it's a hematoma associated with or an pseudoaneurysm. Then always go for a CT angio for getting the documentation. And you need a wide exploration. You usually cannot go through the same incision. The commonest incidence we have found when you have lateral fixation and you put a cerclage wire, that wire goes and profunda is the commonest and anterior, the lateral descending branches, medial and lateral descending femoral branches are the common sites for pseudoaneurysm.
Yes. There is a question in relation to that question. I'll show the question later on. Orthopedic surgeons, they should be able to treat these crush injuries, minor vascular injuries. They should be able to make the flaps, skin grafting, all those things instead of depending upon the plastic surgeons all the time. So yes. What's your
definitely opinion?
Yes.
I'll answer. I am an orthopedic surgeon. You can trained in microsurgery. Definitely you can do it.
Okay. Is an orthopedic surgeon entitled to do a plastic surgery MCH? That's the question I wanted to ask.
Right.
Because in Maharashtra, if I'm right.
Maharashtra was there, sir. JJ Hospital had
it. Now it is not there.
Now it
no,
is
no.
Not.
Orthopedic no. surgeons, it's only for general surgeons can do the plastic surgery course, not the... Yeah.
You can always do a fellowship in hand and microsurgery.
Yes. Okay.
Hey, now, sir, I would like to clarify, like Latish is very good in hand and microsurgery. So he is capable and he is well trained. So he is capable of some question came. So he is capable of that.
Answer
but
the
it
question.
Is always nice to, if you are not exposed to it, it is nice to have a other specialty like a vascular surgeon available. See, yes. People always say that there is no available plastic surgeon or vascular surgeon in their city or town. But as you see, most of the time, by the time patient arrives and you put X-fix, it always takes around 2 to 3 hours. You get an angio done. It is always enough time to mobilize somebody to always have in your friend circle patient yeah. or the doctors you will always need.
No, but because majority of the crush injuries are seen by orthopedic surgeons. Correct. Unfortunately, yeah. orthopedic surgery is not a, even a paper in MBBS level in our curriculum in the medical college. And even if the orthopedic surgeon is treating all these crush injuries, vascular injuries is the first point. He is not able to do MCH plastic surgery is the second point. Yes. He's just to wanted to bring this. I have a question from Dr. Srijit Murali from Kerala, just now received.
Yeah, I saw that.
Isn't it the high time that orthopedic training be more inclusive of learning soft skills like vascular repair, femoral and below, brachial and below, especially when all trauma cases come to orthopedic surgeons and more so when surgeons posted in periphery or without other specialty help like the plastic and vascular surgeons available. Everywhere in the world, it's a 5 years course and they have all the vascular wound technique covering being taught. So that's the question he has asked. Your opinion. I'll come to Srijit Latish first.
I think as you can start thinking about it, that all orthopedic surgeons should have a basic training. There are a lot of centers in India as such. I think Ganga is the best place to where everybody can get trained to that.
Yes.
But it is your interest and your need, what you feel, no? That everybody may not be interested. So if you feel that it is additional skill which you want to acquire, I think you should go and learn it.
No, instead of just having a certificate is also good. No, I am interested to do after MS orthopedics, MCH plastic surgery. As an orthopedic surgeon, it is not allowed.
As a IOA president, you should be knowing about the technique.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Let me ask the plastic surgeon whether they want the competition from an orthopedic surgeon. Ajinkya.
Actually, any orthopedician or surgeon, both can go for plastic surgery. But within these 3 years of plastic surgery also, all the things are not covered. So I think only 3 years course is very difficult to cover all the aspects of orthoplastic.
No, we are not covering all those things.
Yeah.
We are only talking, I have done MS orthopedics now today. I want to do MCH plastic surgery. Why plastic surgery orthopedic surgeons are not eligible for applying for that post itself? In Maharashtra at least, I am not aware elsewhere. Yeah,
I'll add one more point.
Latif said we can do fellowship.
No, plastic surgery is quite a vast subject, sir. And I think we are learning only a small part of it. I don't think it is right for orthopedics to go and do.
The letter, actually, I think you forgot I am also a plastic surgeon. So,
okay.
Yeah.
So, I thought you are MS orthopedics.
No.
Okay.
I know more orthopedics than plastic.
Yeah.
So the letter which he mentioned, other countries, so what happens is in most of the America and all Europe, they do a double fellowship. So if they are head of orthopedic and plastic, like Scott Cosin or Stephen Scott Levin, they do a double fellowship. I think it is always the better lesson is for all. First of all, I would encourage all orthopedic trainees to do open injuries, sir. Forget about soft injuries, because many centers, they don't do open injuries, then they just send to government hospital. They avoid open injuries. So first, good fixation, open injuries, and always learn soft tissue skills, because it is always nice. It depends on your practice. If your practice has a lot of soft tissue injuries, you can always learn local flaps. You can learn a lot of soft tissue reconstruction. But the advantage of collaboration is that even if in all the cases he presented, if you have a vascular surgeon available or a soft tissue for flap a plastic surgeon available, you will find that technology is advancing so fast in all the specialties. See, the type of fixation he presented shows really world-class fixations. That is not possible by any of other reconstructive surgeons. Whereas vascular surgery is advanced so much. So if you call a vascular surgeon, he'll always explore and repair. He will not go for waiting and watching and seeing. So that is advantage. So if you call as a plastic surgeon, there are many wounds I saw which he had presented. I would have done a flap, like the lady with the hand, a lady with the degloving injury. So the threshold level for each of us is different. So I think the lesson we need to teach the younger generation is to collaborate, involve more people around you, and keep on, because every subspecialty is advancing at a very rapid rate.
Yes. Any comment from Gurpal Singh?
I totally agree with Dr. Hari. That's the model that we follow.
Yeah,
that's correct.
I think yes. We can get trained to basic. It's part of our curriculum to do basic microsurgery for residents, but there's no way we can keep up. So we have to be collaborative. And on the orthopedic oncology side, I'm trained to do vascular repairs, but I still call a vascular surgeon. Yeah. I still call my plastic surgery colleague. Sometimes, even if he comes in and blesses my flap, it's still important to have his presence.
To have an expert by the side.
Yes. Yeah. I think we need to keep that humility within us. And the outcomes are always better with a multidisciplinary approach and collaboration.
Yes. Yes, Manoj, you can give the final answer. Then you can continue with your presentation.
I think we could find a middle way as to every orthopedic surgeon may not be having privilege to know everything about plastic surgery, but maybe a 6 months additional out job in plastic surgery, where at least the immediate explorations or the vascular repairs or where the initial decision making is very important to cover those wounds or not. So this kind of basic training every orthopedician should take, especially those who are working in rural areas, where they are referring patients for vascular injuries. Maybe like in wartime, where the shunting injuries were very common, who has saved so many limbs. So maybe such kind of procedures could be a part of curricular in orthopedics as well, so that we could save more limbs, so we can save their morbidities. And this simple 6 months to 1 month could be a good additional training apart from MS orthopedics. So most of the people should do so that we could certainly give even better, because once we start working with plastic surgeon, we understand their perspective is totally different than an orthopedician. Their wound management is totally different. They do have very different principles than what an actual orthopedician follows. So maybe a combined like an emergency orthopedician should be able to do those things. But if he is available, take his help and simultaneously making a good decision in salvage or reconstruction of those particular limb will be certainly much beneficial.
Okay. Yeah. Before you continue with your presentation, just the question, what is the protocol you use, medical management after the vascular repair, or where you doubt vascular repair, how do you treat, what are the medicines you give to those patients where there is a doubtful vascular injury to improve the vascular?
Usually the physicians, they are available round the clock. And usually if we find there is some suspected vascular injury or we have done the vascular repair, as I already told you, usually those patients are put on heparin. They are monitored with the coagulation screening parameters. Further bleeding or hematoma, which is happening in the wounds, their limb is continuously monitored with the SpO2 monitors attached to that particular limb. We mark the pulsation site so that this nursing could intermittently take these pulses properly so as to see the vascularity. And you need to monitor the neurological function as well, because that could deteriorate sometimes. Nerve ischemia and other things could start happening. So continuous further monitoring of all these parameters is essential.
Okay. Yeah, you can continue with your presentation.
Okay. So we'll come to the last part of this talk. Again, very interesting, as various vascular injuries which could happen after elective surgeries, as already mentioned, they are very unpleasant and has got very high medical legal issues, because patients will find this as an unacceptable complications. And usually the patients will not have much sympathy toward the surgeon, because they will feel that this direct injury to a vascular structure has happened during a very uncomplicated orthopedic case. So you need to be very cautious, and mainly the injury during elective procedure is caused mainly because of indirect trauma. This is the majority of the reason. It is usually the traction to the joint or placement of your retractor or instrument while exposure. And sometimes these another factors like anatomical aberrations or severe deformities, like complex deformities where you're operating and the anatomy is altering, or sometimes there is prior adhesions because of previous injury. So these are the particular factors which will make it prone for indirect injury, even these things. Then second less common cause are the direct injuries. It is usually most of the time the indirect injuries, but sometimes directly perforation which is caused by the sharp instrument can also be seen with the drill or saw of knife, but though this is rare. But regardless whether it's a direct injury or indirect injury, you need to early recognize this kind of vascular injury is very critical to prevent the irreversible damage which could happen. So you need to have protocols to mandate that neurovascular check, as already mentioned, at regular intervals of these postoperative patients. Like for a, even I go for a knee replacement or hip replacement, preoperatively my assistant will mark the pulse, and postoperatively he will inform me that postoperative pulse is there. And in my routine notes, like in the evening or whenever there's some the resident doctor informs me, he will certainly inform the neurovascular structure, the toe movements, the finger movements are present or not, or the disturbances are present or not. So this continuous monitoring and protocols properly will certainly help. And there are multiple issues sometimes which could happen, as Dr. Gurpal Singh was mentioning, in delay in identification, because if you have applied a tourniquet while surgery for knee replacement, it could conceal the profound bleeding immediately, and later on the bleeding could appear even with the direct injuries. Sometimes the location of the vessels is too deep, sometimes the acetabular screws sometimes could cause inner pelvic bleeding, which could go unnoticed for a while. And as rightly mentioned, that intimal damage itself will not manifest immediately in the period of time. It will take some time, and we have usually missed those injuries during this early postoperative period. So we need to identify this high-risk patient. Again, this is a very unresolved issue, whether we should go for all vascular check for all patients preoperatively or not, because that is a cumbersome additional investigation preoperatively which we are dealing with to undergo for all these patients necessary. But certainly those are high-risk, having some kind of vascular problem, PVD or such kind of thing. They should always go for a vascular consultation first prior to the surgery. And pre-existing vascular disease certainly puts them at a higher risk, even with minimal traction, to damage the vessel. So there is still no conclusive evidence as to whether you need to screen all these patients with vascular experts or not. These are the few points which I have tried to come out, which would cause chances of iatrogenic injury more. Like if you are giving uncontrolled and more traction, very rough manipulation, long time pressures on the vascular vessels, like you are not supporting those properly during your positions, long standing procedures, close reduction, blind reductions, then BPO techniques, minimally invasive, what we call it, is good chances more of a vascular injury by poking blindly with the sharp instruments or K wires or implants. And closure without hemostasis, again, very essential, could sometimes lead to a big hematoma or hemorrhage inside. So I would like to quote few examples which I come across. Like this is a young male, the simple supracondylar fracture. Surgeon has missed the vascular anatomy which was there. He hasn't mentioned any whether preoperatively pulse there is or not. It should always be marked and properly documented. He came after around 5 days of surgery that his distal limb pulsations were not there. And gradually, you can see this kind of rotated fragment was causing compression on the popliteal artery. And gradually, as you can see, the limb ischemia has already started happening. The compartment, all the muscles are getting ischemic, necrotic. And further fasciotomy, you can see that it's getting infected, patient landing into DIC. And we cannot save his limb, and he need to undergo a bone amputation. So proper documentation of these pre-op pulses, post-op pulses, and monitoring, even with this close kind of injuries, is very essential. Another very simple example in orthopedic, a calcaneal fracture. I had done an extensive lateral approach for this, and this patient developed wound anteromedially. It is surgical wound has healed completely, but there was a blackening which is happening anteromedially, gradually a big ischar, and you can see a big non-healing ulcer has started appearing. So this is because of retraction which I have done, and some of the branch tributaries of vessel must have been damaged. And this patient again needed another flap surgery to cover all these things. So you need to be very cautious, even simple retraction to cause such kind of vascular insult. Another simple complication, I don't know whether it's like a cutaneous necrosis and peeling of skin. I operated hip, maybe some compression over the popliteal vessel was very high after some time. But again, this resolved very well, but some cutaneous ischemia had happened, and luckily nothing further proceeded. This is the case which I brought it from Dr. Virendra. It's a supracondylar femoral nailing was done around 3 weeks back, and as you can see, the patient presented with this, such a kind of swelling, and as regularly mentioned by Dr. Hari, you should not poke this, you should not needle it, just do a vascular angio. And the CT angio was done, and which were demonstrating a pseudoaneurysm which was formed because of that working fragment where you can see. So it was immediately explored, all these things were completely taken out. The poking fragment which was there, which was again explored, and it was recirculated with another few wires, and the pulses started reappearing once we had done all the vascular procedure. A different wide incision you need to take again to repair such kind of pseudoaneurysms. Another example is shared by Dr. Nissal, like a post arthroscopy PCL procedure, patient has got no pulses. You can see the waveform is completely absent somehow. And on further exploration, there was a complete laceration which was seen in this popliteal artery. You can just mark it out. This was a laceration which was caused by the blind instrument with some sharp injury which has happened because during the arthroscopy. So such kind of complication can happen, and this happens when interposition was graft done for this patient, and immediately circulation started, appeared, and a good waveform, as you can see, this low waveform and then the high spice good waveform with 100% oxygen should be done. Another post knee replacement, Dr. Gurpal Singh must be interested. Like again, most of the post knee replacement patients sometimes doesn't have pulses. So we started worrying. Sometimes there are some major some spasm compression which could be there, which suddenly one or two hours after surgery sometimes come. But again, if the patient doesn't have what pulses, you need to certainly go for a Doppler study, then angiography, which could sometimes delineate some kind of injury and this thing formation. And I feel that post knee replacement, most of these can be documented very properly with a good angiography, and this procedure, interventional radiologists with endovascular procedure can deal with this kind of injuries most commonly, because it is not complete injury most of the times after knee replacement. But still, they cannot say a laceration or transection which could have happened. There are two cases which are taken from Google, like this is a post total hip replacement case. The patient after hip replacement after 3 months, he has presented with a huge swelling and pain in this iliac fossa region in the flank. And you can see on the CT, there is a huge mass which has been developing in the iliac fossa, which is compressing surrounding vessel. So it is nothing but which has come out is a femoral vein injury which has caused during the surgery. So it is again because of the proximity of these vascular structures to the hip joint could cause even such venous injuries which could present in a much later stage with such a big hematoma in the left flank. Another very, very rare case which I have found out in the internet as after lumbar disc surgery in a young male, he has started developing post-surgery cool and pale limbs with decreased pulsations. So they have done the angiography, and as you can see, there's a iatrogenic aorta cable formation was there. So there was a this feeling of inferior venae cava during the arterial phase. But again, you need to see that such rare occurrences still can be happening, and we should be cautious. So in conclusion, I would like to say that potential exists with every orthopedic injury. It is not that uncommon what we usually think of. You should be aware of associated these injuries. You should understand the signs and symptoms of injuries. These are very mischievous injuries. And the time, as I already told, is very crucial. Urgent diagnosis and immediate treatment is the crux. The diagnosis with a high index of suspicion and even a thorough physical examination is very essential. You should have your own defined protocol for whatever particular setup which you are operating with. And very essential is to keep your colleagues from the intervention radiology, vascular surgery always there, because what I find, these cases usually come at very odd hours. And usually you need to ring and call everybody. So availability of this manpower, inventory, and proper protocol will certainly help you in giving good results in such kind of vascular injuries. So we'll come to that question, is what is orthopedic surgeon is ultimately afraid of? So I think it is postoperative absence of pulse or a major neurological problem. Because if this gets, sometimes if pulse we identify early, we can reverse it back. If the neurological injury is there, we cannot predict the recovery. So, but certainly orthopedic surgeon will make awake or get afraid because of this, and certainly may not be afraid because of bony or vascular injuries, because it has already occurred. And if you identify it and treat it, you can get away with it. So thank you very much for your kind patience. I hope I have able to put some knowledge into you with a good warm brain circulation. So this is how we can have your journey from a pulseless limb to a pink limb. Ultimately, we say that the fingers are pink or the toes are pink. That is the ultimate satisfaction which we all get after treating these vascular injuries. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mann.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That was a very lovely talk. And definitely, this is what we had missed in the last 5-6 months of Corona. We were not having any webinar on this topic. And I'm glad that you could take this topic as an orthopedic surgeon and do more than just is what I was expecting out of you. So really, thank you. I don't have any words to express the about the cases you are treated so nicely, in spite of being having so many problems and so many other complications associated. As you rightly said, it's the teamwork which is more important rather than having the ego of treating everything by you only. So it's a good lesson we all have to learn by your presentation. Open to all the faculty for their comments and any discussion. You can stop sharing, Manoj.
I should congratulate Dr. Manoj. I think it's a Herculean task to have a documentation of so many cases. Now, I know that it is very difficult to have that follow-up photographs, everything sets up well. And I think he has touched upon all the cases, and I think it's not an easy job to have a one-hour talk like this. And it was quite informative. I have learned a lot of things, and it was a good time interacting with all of you. Thank you very much for giving an opportunity.
Yes. Ajinkya?
I would like to congratulate Manoj sir for this comprehensive lecture, and it was a nice talk.
Thank you. Yeah. Yes, Hari.
Yeah, again, very nice. And especially the last part, as sir said, we should not call it complication too many times. So it is an inadvertent or an adverse outcome. I think that's a better word. I think what you should always, for the younger trainees, is that whenever you do non-union, mal unions, and very difficult orthopedic reductions, preoperatively itself, you should warn the patient about two things. As you said, you are too afraid of two things. One is vascularity, other is the neurology. So both you have to say the bone is always hugged by the artery and vein, and God always protects it by bone in the front. So whenever bone gets injured, it is high chances that both others may also likely to be injured. So always warn them before, and always keep your hand on the pulse. And however senior you become, Dr. Savapathy always says, good habits do not die. So feel the pulse, feel the sensation, see the toe moving. I think 2-3 things for every patient, like we do a timeout. You should have an internal timeout that you should always look for the vascularity and the sensation.
Yes. Any comments from Gurupal?
Again, thank you, Manoj. It is very, very comprehensive. And congratulations on managing these difficult cases. Thank you very much, Dr. Shiva, for having me here. Can I just say one small thing about the last part? I think prevention is everything. For example, when we do a knee replacement, people who have done fellowships with me will tell you that I've never let anyone do the posterior femoral condylar cut. Even with the best fellow I had, I let him. At some point, I'm standing there scrubbed in, and I've let him do a knee from skin to skin. But when it came to that posterior femoral condylar cut, I do it myself. So, because in the event that something goes wrong, you only have yourself to blame. You know, it's not, So at the end, even for the hip, for example, we talk about acetabular screw placement.
Yeah.
I find that this whole concept of quadrants of safety, you know, if you end up just, the quadrants of safety concept was actually published, you know, we won't go into the details of the publication now, but it's a very good guide. But at the end of the day, I always teach my fellows, you know, if you take your fingers and you palpate the sciatic notch on one side, you know that you cannot go more, you know, you cannot deviate more than that because the sciatic nerve is there. And you can actually palpate, you know, the pelvic table here, and you know that your screw, you can get a nice 40-50 millimeter screw right up the pelvis in between. So I think at some point the challenge is that we need to actually move away from the textbook or the concepts that we have read. And when we are on the operating table, there's actually a, you know, it's a learning curve journey of every surgeon. So once we get that, I mean, you know, clearly, another example is, you know, placement of retractors, Chanli retractors that are used in hip replacement. I've often seen them catch the nerve. I never use any of those. I use one of these broad, almost like an abdominal retractor. I visualize the sciatic nerve in every posterior approach, maybe because I've done orthopedic oncology. And sometimes, you know, we as orthopedicians, we feel, let's just stay away from this place because there's danger. There is danger if you don't see it. If you see it, you know where it is, then you'll preserve it. So, I mean, that's my 2 cents worth. Thank you.
So your message is, "Dar ke aage jeet hai."
Anji.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Any burning question or any additional anybody wants to add before we call it a day? We already overshot by 25 minutes.
Yes.
That's
nice. Yes. I think you should just document all your cases and write a small book on it.
Yes. That's a good, great compliment, Manoj. So I would like to thank Dr. Manoj for this wonderful talk on this very rare subject. Orthopedic surgeon normally talks that the vascular injuries. Really, it was an eye-opener for me. And definitely, there are so many subtle vascular injuries we will be missing. And probably after hearing this lecture, many of us will take a cue from that and prevent such mishap happening in our own hands. I would like to thank Dr. Hari Venkatramani from Ganga Hospital, Dr. Gurpal Singh from Singapore, Dr. Litesh Leo from Latish. I've been talking as a Litesh over the time. Latish Leo from Mangalore and Dr. Ajikya Ukrande from Shulapur. Of course, we had Soumya Datta for some time from Calcutta, but he had internet issues and that's why he couldn't join. So I thank all of you for having joined to take this discussion in a wonderful way for the so that all the viewers are benefited to a great extent. Meet again sometime soon on some other platform.
Yes.
Day after tomorrow, again, I'll just remind there'll be talk, one person, one talk series by Dr. Gadegone, Vasudev Gadegone from Chandrapur, and he'll be talking on forearm nailing at the same time. Thank you very much. Bye bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye, everybody. Bye. Thank you.
I'll stop the streaming. Okay. Streaming. Ashok, you are there? No, I am unable to stop streaming. No, okay. Okay, we'll exit.
We'll leave it there.
We'll exit. Bye-bye.